the commercial that you shot, you were originally going to work with somebody else, right? Well, how did the first...
It was an advertising agency in Amarillo, Texas, who wrote the script.
Oh, I see.
A woman scriptwriter, very good. She wrote the script based on using a local TV clown from Amarillo, Texas. And I was down in the office of the head of the agency in Amarillo, McCormick Agency, and I said, you can't use a local clown. The guy says, he's very good. He's very good in pantomime. I said, well, you should use this for this kind of a script. It was beautifully underplayed.
Yeah.
I said, you should get Chaplin, or then I bit my tongue, or Keaton. And the agency boss says, yeah, sure. So he picks up the phone, takes a long-distance call, and I'm still sitting there. Because you don't talk when you're on the phone.
Right.
So when he hang up the phone, he'd say, okay, so who can we get? And I said, I'm thinking. So he'd call some more. And in the middle of one of his calls, I went like this. I signaled to him. I said, got it. He hangs up the phone. Who? I said, Buster Keaton. He said, not a bad idea.
Yeah.
I didn't even know if Buster would do it.
Yeah.
But we contacted...
What year was this? You can remember. Early 50s, late 50s?
No, early, very late 50s or early 60s.
Yeah.
Anyhow, I can find out.
Yeah.
The point is that we contacted Buster in Hollywood, and I don't remember how we did it, but the point is we got an answer back. Oh, I wrote him a letter. There was some back and forth from our front office at Alexander Studios with getting Keaton. And then I wrote him a letter, once there was agreement, I wrote him a letter, sent him a script, and I said, Dear Buster, if I may call you Buster, if you're not too tired after the shooting, we'd like to invite you to a screening of our favorite, maybe I said one of our favorite films, The General.
Right.
You know, just softening him up to so that he would be invited to a screening, which was going to be held at the Fine Arts Center, 16 millimeter hard metal folding seats.
And this is in Colorado Springs.
Colorado Springs. Yeah. I was one of the directors of this film society that met once a month. But this is not bad to get Keaton there. And I hope we'd get him there in person. Anyhow, after a day of shooting, he did agree. Took it down. We went down. He goes down this city.
Yeah.
he said, just don't introduce me. We go in after the lights go down. So they had saved some seats on the aisle. And we went in. He sat on one seat in the aisle, and I sat right behind him.
Yeah.
And I'm probably the only person in the world who has ever viewed the General blocked by Keaton's head.
Yeah.
And you know, people are falling out of their seats, onto the floor, up in the rafters, and his head didn't move.
Huh.
So here's the screen, and here's the silhouette of his deadpan head.
Yeah.
Motionless, absolutely motionless. Anyhow, the lights come on at the end of the show. He's gone. I said, oh my God, he disappeared. And I look up, he's on stage. Mm-hmm. In the dark, as the lights are going down, he rushed out of his seat and got up on the stage, and he has his hands behind his back, his heels together, and he's leaning over about 45 degrees.
Uh-huh.
And after the applause stopped, he shifted to the other side and said, any questions? So, I don't know if there were any questions, because everybody was so dumbfounded. And of course, most of the people there had not seen the General.
Right.
And they were just in rapture, because this is an audience of about 75 people, 65. And we didn't guarantee that he would be there, but we did pass the word around that he was in town. In fact, there was a picture in the local paper of yours truly greeting Keaton at the plane. Poor guy looked tired and worn from the trip to Hollywood, but at least there's a picture of me shaking hands with him.
How much did the script change from when he got there?
Only little ad-lib businesses that either he or I or both together came up with. But basically it was the script as this woman had written it.
Uh-huh.
about a man servicing his old 1923, yeah. I think, Pierce Arrow.
Right.
We had a Pierce Arrow in town. A friend of mine owned it. He was a collector. And I called him and I said, listen, we're going to do this thing with Buster Keaton. Can we borrow your car? And he says, it's all apart up at the so-and-so garage. And I said, oh, well, never mind. We got another one lined up.
Yeah.
He said, no. I'll get it.
Yeah.
His Pierce Arrow is up 20 miles west of Colorado Springs, all apart, you know, on the floor.
Yeah.
So he says, I'll have him sweep up the parts and put it in the bucket and we'll tow it down.
Yeah.
I said, don't. So anyhow, we did our film with him, and he added some things and I added some things, but basically it was just the owner of the car looking very pleased at the car, going up and flicking a piece of dust off of the hood.
Yeah.
And then he goes back to he lifts up the engine, the hood, puts in some oil, mm-hmm. and he goes to the rear of the car, puts in some gasoline, and he pats the pump.
Yeah.
Thankfully, he pats the pump. Then he gets back in the car, and we cut. This is all mostly one take, one scene. He gets in the car, and we see him through the front windshield making the OK sign. Mm-hmm. And behind his shoulder, you can see the Shamrock Gas and Oil logo. But every take we did, he came up with different little businesses.
Uh-huh.
In one, if he would blow a take, he or I would blow a take and yell cut. He'd keep going for a little bit. At one point, he got into the car. I think this was in the outtake.
Yeah.
He closed the door on his foot.
No, I didn't see that.
And in another one, he got in and he had forgotten to put the hood down.
That's what I saw.
And I yelled to him at the critical point. I said, the hood! And he... I knew it wouldn't rattle him, but I didn't know how to get out of it. I thought he'd just go put the hood down and get in the car. But we're doing this rather dangerously because the whole thing is almost one master take.
Yeah.
And so we've got to be close on the timing. But we had a couple of cutaways and we would have done something. But he came up with the idea of reaching in to where the flowers hanging in the flower vase and pulling out a feather duster and dusting off the engine. And then when he wanted to get rid of the feather duster, he didn't know where to put it. He stuck it in his back, the rear of his belt, and he's doing some other work, and then all of a sudden it tickled him, and he pulled it out and jumped. He did so much ad-libbing.
Yeah.
And at one time, he got into the car and he hadn't put the hood down, and I didn't yell cut, and he's not going to stop until somebody yells cut. So he crawled out through the window.
Yeah.
Did you see that one?
That's what I remember seeing. What's interesting is that the spot, I've seen a lot of other commercials that he did, and usually a lot of the stuff that he does, there's a lot more physical business, falls and stuff like that. And what's interesting about the Shamrock spot, it's just very subtle, very light stuff.
Very quiet.
Yeah, did he want to add anything? Or he was willing to go right along with whatever the script was?
Oh, sure. The only thing he added, as I say, were little touches, but they were so good.
But he stuck basically to what the script was.
Oh, sure. Sure. He told me so many anecdotes when we were having lunch or dinner, because I just wouldn't let him get away. But after the show, when we ran the general, he grabbed a folding chair, turned it around, and he sat on it backwards.
Mm-hmm.
And he held onto the rear of the chair. And he talked to us for about an hour of different story.
Yeah.
There were only a couple of questions from the audience because you couldn't shut him up.
Right.
He was so funny. And telling things like the fire that was started when they burned the trestle.
Oh, right.
And burned a lot of the timber up there.
Yeah.
And they had to get out of the Northern California and get back to Hollywood because they couldn't shoot because of all this smoke.
Mm.
And then they went back.
He was pleasant to work with, Keaton?
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful person.
did you make any suggestions at all, or was it basically just walk through the thing and you let him do what he wanted?
No, we had the basic script.
Yeah.
He added something, and then I added something, and we would confer. And of course, a lot of what you decide to do is based on time.
Yeah.
Because I had never made a 90-second commercial before.
Right.
I was in heaven. Most I'd ever handled was 60 seconds.
Right.
And it's the feeling was very funny to come from New York, 20-second television spots,
yeah,
and go to Alexander and start to make 30-second,
yeah,
in color. You have no idea what 10 more seconds can do,
yeah,
for you. Well, you will when I get you a tape of some of the things we did out there.
Yeah.
Because they were amazing. But Keaton's anecdotes at the time we ran the General,
yeah,
had that audience spellbound.
Yeah.
They were so spellbound that they really didn't ask any questions.
Sure.
And so he would segue into another story or, yeah, another something.
Was he pleased with the spot?
Well, I hate to tell you this, but when he was leaving at the airport, I said, well, certainly a pleasure to work with you, et cetera, et cetera. And I said, would you like me to send you a copy of the spot?
Mm-hmm.
He said, no. Broke my heart.
Really?
Absolutely broke my heart.
Hmm.
You know, it was just a job to him. He did it. He was paid, I think, $1,500 to come from Hollywood, plus expenses.
Right.
I think that's what the fee was. I have a still that I cherish. It's somebody shot of Keaton and I together.
Oh, really?
And he looks so sad. He's facing the camera, and he looks so sad. And I look so goofy because from the rear, my ears stick out bigger than Clark Gable's.
Uh-huh.
But we're standing there on the stage, nose to nose. Obviously, somebody's made a suggestion, and the other party is considering it.
Uh-huh.
It's a wonderful still because it's a moment in time where we're not standing with our arms around each other,
yeah,
smiling and looking at the camera.
You're working. You're both working.
We're working, but what an expression! I have my arms folded and I'm kind of staring down at him.
Yeah.
You know, he's not a giant.
Yeah.
I was staring down at him a little, and he's looking kind of through me off,
yeah,
into space and standing thinking.
Wow.
And whatever it was, it had only taken a split second.
Sure.
Because we didn't stand around the set looking like that. But and it's a wonderful picture. I love it. Thank you.